My name is Christopher Allen, and I joined the Blockly team last year to help the team with some of the work that it's doing modernizing the Blockly codebase. As part of that work, I've been looking at how blocks are defined and at the library of predefined blocks that we provide for common programming constructs like if statements, loops, variables, and so on. I've been discovering the history of how blocks are defined and thinking about how it might change in the future. This talk is going to be part archaeology and part futurology. I'll share a little bit of what I've learned, talk a bit about where we are now, and share some of our thoughts about possible plans for the future. Let's start by looking at some examples of how blocks have been defined in the past. Neil Fraser was kind enough to provide me with some copies of the Blockly codebase that predate the earliest commits in our current Git repository. The first two versions he has, dating from 2011, don't have any predefined blocks at all, just a very early version of the block factory tool that allows one to define a block interactively. The first recognizable library of block definitions appears in a version from March 2012. Here is an excerpt from the file language.core.js. There are a few things about this code that I find interesting. First, there's no module system in use yet. The script just tacks a namespace object onto the root Blockly namespace object and then creates block definitions as properties on that object. Those block definitions are just plain object literals with a bunch of properties. The constructor of the block class, not shown here, takes a block name as a string, looks it up in Blockly.language namespace to get one of these definitions, which it describes as a prototype, even though they are in fact used as mixins. The properties defined here get copied onto the freshly created block object. This is largely how block definitions continue to work today. You'll note that so far we have just two properties to mix in. One is the init function that you may be familiar with. The other is part of the JavaScript code generator. The init function itself sets up the newly created block by calling various methods to set the color, title text, and inputs. The block is defined in code. By the way, at this time, blocks did not yet have fields as such, although the init function could set a flag to allow the user to edit the block's title, giving the block a single ersatz string-valued field. Here's an example from the first version of Blockly to appear in our current Git repository. At this time, Blockly development was still being done in an SVN repository on Google Code, but Ellen Spertus had begun mirroring it to Git, and a year later, this would become the official GitHub repo for the project. Compared to the previous version, there have been a few changes. First, Blockly is now using the closure module system with Goog provide. This isn't conceptually different from the manually created namespace objects of the previous version, but it meant the project could now be compiled with the closure compiler. The block definitions now live in the Blockly.blocks definitions dictionary. The if block definition now comprises quite a number of different methods, not just init. But notably, there is one that is missing. The toJavaScript method is gone, with all of the JavaScript generation code having been moved to a separate module entirely. This meant that Blockly could easily support generating code in many different languages from the same set of block definitions. Finally, the init method is now using strings from Blockly.message, meaning that we have support for localization into different languages. One key feature of this is that the actual layout of the block, what order the various inputs, fields, labels, and so on appear in it, can be modified by the translators rather than being hard-coded into the block definition itself. But overall, our block definition still consists of a mixin object with some methods in which the init method sets things up by calling various methods on the Blockly object. The objects are still being defined in code. The definition of our if block doesn't change all that much for the next 3 years, but in February 2017, a commit by Andrew Marshall arrives that dramatically revises its definition. Gone is the previous mixin object. Instead, the block is defined by passing an array of very simple object literals without any methods to a new function, defineBlocksWithJSONArray. The reason for this change was that Blockly was growing in popularity and efforts had begun to write native ports of Blockly for Android in Java and iOS in Swift. Replacing the previous procedural block definitions with this new declarative style made it easier to share the definitions between the ports. To that end, you will note that the block definitions are written in a JSON-compatible syntax with double-quoted property names and so on. This means that they could be extracted as JSON text and used verbatim in the other ports, and you will see some special comments here to help the extractor script find the correct parts of the file to extract. Defining new blocks still needed some actual code in most cases, of course, but now the code was separated out into extensions. Here we see the controls if block definition, including a request for the corresponding controls if extension. The extensions would need to be ported to native code for each platform, of course, but as much as possible of the block definition was now in a platform-neutral declarative format. Now, let's have a look at a few changes that have been made in the most recent releases of Blockly. Compared to the version we just saw from 5 years ago, there are only a few notable changes in this snippet, but each of them points towards our future plans. First, we're still using the closure module system, but we've moved from Goog provide modules, which are basically namespace objects without their own scope, to Goog module, which has semantics much closer to those of other module systems like CommonJS or ES modules. This will facilitate the coming transition to TypeScript. We've also renamed the modules which contain block definitions to use the Blockly.LibraryBlocks prefix to more clearly separate them from the core module that defines the Blockly.Blocks dictionary object. Second, instead of using defineBlocksWithJSONArray, we use a new function, createBlockDefinitionsFromJSONArray, which digests the declarations as before, but does not install the resulting block definitions by adding them to the Blockly.Blocks dictionary. Instead, it just returns them. The block definitions are installed using another new function, defineBlocks, but they are also exported from the module as the named export blocks. What is this about? Okay, let's talk about the future of library blocks. First, a disclaimer. Everything I'm about to talk about is just our current thinking and is subject to change based on what we learn as we continue to modernize and update the Blockly codebase, and also depending on your feedback. Okay, let's go. At the moment, loading any library block module causes the defined blocks to be installed in the Blockly.blocks dictionary. That makes it difficult to control exactly what block definitions are available. If you want to change or modify the predefined set, you have to delete or update entries in the dictionary. And if we add new blocks, you may have to add new deletions to your code if you don't want our additions. To solve this problem, we'd like to make the library block module's side effect free. We started that process by separating the creation from the installation and by explicitly exporting the block definitions from each of the library blocks modules. Now we're considering removing the call to define blocks. That will mean that if you want to use the library blocks, you'll have to make this call to install them yourself. But it will also mean that you have the opportunity to pick and choose exactly which block definitions get installed. We're planning to do the same thing with extensions, by the way. Define and export them in the library blocks module and let developers install the ones they need. There are some things we need to think about. For example, how to ensure the correct extensions are installed for a given set of blocks. We'd welcome your thoughts about these plans. There's a bug open about this work, number 5875. Please add your comments and suggestions there. So, we've separated the definition of a block from the installation of that definition for use. We've exported the blocks defined by each module from that module. We're proposing to stop doing the installation automatically, so developers can choose which of the exported block definitions they want to use. That will make the library block module side effect free. Finally, once we've done that, the next obvious question is, do they even need to exist in the core Blockly repository at all? Or could we move them to plugins? This would reduce the size of the Blockly NPM package, which would be beneficial, especially for those who don't use the library blocks at all. It might also help us streamline development. There are some technical issues, though. Since there is some integration between the library blocks and Blockly core, and the block definitions are needed by the generators and used in various tests, including in the playground, it probably only makes sense to move the blocks to plugins if we also move the generators. We'll need to investigate what's involved before making a decision about whether it's worthwhile. I hope you found this little tour of the history and future of block definitions interesting. We're looking forward to hearing your thoughts about our plans. If you have questions, you can post them in our Q&A or bring them to a Q&A session at the summit. And of course, we always welcome relevant comments on issues and pull requests in the Blockly repository. Thanks very much.